And what is your reaction to the movie that is being made based on your books?
I'm delighted with the film. It is, of course, there are elements of fiction in it, and they could not possibly compress 10 years of experiences into a 2-hour film. They had more information to work with than a standard producer does in terms of their materials, because not only did they have the case files of Ed and Lorraine Warren for the investigation they conducted at the house, they also had everything that I gave them, which was in total volume one, parts of volume two, a 3-page detailed timeline of events chronologically listed, and 75 pages in treatment. We wanted the story to be told as authentically as possible, and so I was delighted when we went to the set last March while they were filming in Wilmington, and finally got to meet all these people that I'd been working with, email, phone, you know. I knew then, I had no more trepidation once I met the cast, the crew, the director, James Wan. He has handled this project masterfully and has painted the story in very broad strokes, because ultimately what the story is about is the conflict of good and evil and the ability for love to conquer fear. And so I feel that the entire story is well represented now, because he painted this tapestry in art, in film, and the fine lines of history and the detail are in the books. So that way it's all out.
And how hard was it for you and your family to sort of let go and have Warner Brothers take it over and have the rights to basically your life and your portrayal of your events?
It was the biggest leap of faith of all, because when I signed that contract 4 years ago, I signed my name on behalf of my entire family, and I handed this project over to strangers who have since become my friends. So I prayed. I just prayed to God, please do it justice. This is very dense, dark, complicated material. Just treat it with respect. And that's exactly what has happened. They were always cognizant of the fact that they were telling the story of people who are still alive. And they treated it with the utmost dignity and respect and intelligence. That's the thing that people are going to be shocked by. They will leave this film stunned and astonished, but they will also leave this film educated.
Can you just talk a little bit about the events that went on while you were living in the house?
Well, it started the first day that we moved into the house. We saw a man standing in the dining room who seemed fixated on watching dear old Mr. Kenyon, who had sold the property to my parents. I walked past him and said, good morning. And he didn't respond to me, but I had a box in my hands. I just kept going. And then Cindy came into the kitchen right after me, and she said, Mom, who's that man in the dining room? And Mom said, Mr. Kenyon. She said, no, the other man. And Mom said, there is no other man. And then Nancy came in and leaned over to Cindy and said, you know that other man in the dining room? He just disappeared. Well, and thus it began. We moved into that farm never anticipating, not even considering the possibility that the farm could be haunted. It didn't occur to any of us, including my parents. It wasn't on the radar, but it was as of the first day. And when we had finished unpacking the truck, Mr. Kenyon came to my father and he said, Roger, take a walk with me. And they went out into the side yard in the middle of a swirling snowstorm. And he put his hand on my father's arm and he said, Roger, for the sake of your family, leave the lights on at night. And it wasn't until weeks later, when we started getting to know the people in the neighborhood, that we found out that for all the years that the Kenyons had lived in that farm, there was never a night that every single light in that house wasn't on, and that house glowed all night long.
When did you start having did you have second thoughts about leaving the house? Did your parents say, oh, we shouldn't be here, why don't you stay?
The question that I am asked most is, what is wrong with you people? Most people say if they had had that happen the day they were moving in, they would have repacked the truck and headed right back out. Well, of course, that wasn't possible. My parents had invested everything they had into this magnificent 200-acre farm, the Arnold Estate. And what I tell people is there are 100 different reasons why we stayed. If people think that what we just went through in terms of economic upheaval in this country was bad, in the early 70s, there were gas lines, an oil embargo. The Nixon administration was in turmoil. It was on the verge of Watergate happening. There were prices of everything were going up. Inflation was through the roof. The price of the property started to plummet. There was no way that my parents could have turned around and sold that property for anything remotely close to what they paid for it. It would have financially ruined our family. That aside, we fell madly in love with this piece of paradise up in the northwest corner of our precious little state. And whenever my mother said, "That's it, we're selling this house," we would cry, we would beg. We knew there were spirits at that time. All of us were having encounters, but we didn't know what her encounters were and how serious they were. Because of course, as a dutiful mother, she was not divulging that information to us. And we figured we'd come to terms and we could handle what was happening to us. Because children are so malleable and so vulnerable at the same time, we had many, many encounters. My little sister Cindy would crawl into bed with me every night and say, "Annie, the voices are back. They come and they surround the bed and they tell me they all speak at once. They say the same thing over and over again. There are 7 dead soldiers buried in the wall. There are 7 dead soldiers buried in the wall." For 10 years, every single night, they came to Cindy and told her. And instead of tearing that wall down, the next owners boarded it off and closed it in completely.
And do you consider this a gift, the experiences that have happened to you? How do you react to this?
It's absolutely a gift, but it wasn't just a gift to us. It is now a gift to the world. We left that house, sold it to the abutting landowners in 1980. We moved in as a perfectly normal family, and we left as a paranormal family, and we were followed, and detachments did occur. My sister Cindy has lights around her all the time. All of us do, really. I travel with my own spirits and guides at all times. I feel utterly loved and protected by my ancestors and those that came before me and that I will someday reunite with. But it was important to tell this story, not just because the world was finally ready, but because over the 3 decades that it took for us to process this information ourselves, for the first decade we didn't discuss it at all with each other. And then we started revisiting it and revisiting it a little bit here, a little bit there, family dinners, that type of thing. But in August of 07, it was as if a bell went off in my head. I had a fabulous job. I was a member of the theater company of Rhode Island for 20 years. I loved my stage work and my singing and my dancing, and my life in Rhode Island was idyllic. And suddenly I found myself turning in my resignation at my job. And I packed up my belongings and my critters, and I moved to Georgia to be close with my family. I knew it was time to tell this story. And my mother, about 6 months in, after I'd moved to Georgia, my mother walked past me one day, and I'm typing away and doing my manuscript, which was actually only supposed to be 1 book. It was just too big to publish as 1 book. So my publisher said, we'll make it a trilogy. Okay, fine. And she walked past me and she said, "Honey, what are you going to title the book?" And I said, "I don't know yet, Mom. I haven't really thought about it." And she said, "House of Darkness, House of Light." And it was, there it was. And I looked at her and she said, "Because it was both." It was the most enlightening decade of my life. I have been privileged to live my entire life from the age of 12, absolutely fearless, knowing that there is something beyond our mortal existence. I was 12 when we moved in, and I'm 54 now, and I don't know any more now than I did as a child about exactly what it is, but it is. And to me, that's miraculous. So I figure this isn't the kind of story one should rightfully take to the grave. This was meant to be shared, and I truly believe that all the elements of the universe that conspired to get us to that farm conspired to keep us on that farm for a full decade. And when we left, we mourned its loss. But my mother had approached my dad in the last year of our tenure there, and she said, "Roger, I won't survive another winter here. I won't." And he said, "That's it. That's it. We'll go." And it languished on the market for a while. And finally, Dad approached the abutting landowners, and they purchased the farm. And Mom and Dad went down to Georgia and found a beautiful place in Cherokee County, and we moved. But we took them, in some respect, we left the farm will never leave us. And I know that at least one of the spirits attached and came with us, because when Mrs. Warren called about 6 weeks after we moved to Georgia, I don't even know how she found us or got our number, but she called and she said, Carolyn, you have to talk to Roger. This is the most intense, the most disturbing, and the most significant research that we have ever conducted on a piece of property worldwide. This story has to go out into the world. And my mother said, oh, Lorraine, I don't want to revisit the past. I want to move forward with my life, and so does my entire family. And I don't know if she even spoke with my father, but she went to throw a load of laundry in that night, and a 200-pound door that my father had very carefully moved and placed in the laundry room so that we could move antiques through the house. It came over on top of her, it dislocated her shoulder, and it gave her a concussion on the agitator of the washing machine, and the decision was made there would be no telling of the story. We waited 30 years.
So what brought you to the point where you could tell the story, where it was okay and you wanted to share it?
I really don't have an answer for that. It was time. It was as though an old-fashioned alarm clock went off in my head. I don't even know what transpired to bring it. It hadn't been much. I really hadn't even been thinking about it. And then suddenly, it was there. And then I got validation and confirmation, because I was a few weeks into compiling notes of my own personal recollections. I was putting them on little note cards in a recipe box. I hadn't even begun an official manuscript, and I got my first call from Hollywood, and I said, bingo, it's time.
I got a few here. I take down notes on my phone. Everything else written down on. I saw in the trailer, does this take place in Huntsville, Rhode Island?
Harrisville.
Oh, Harrisville, okay. Where's that?
Harrisville is one of the villages of Burrillville. Burrillville is the far northwest corner of the state. It's the largest town in the state, and it has, I think, 10 villages total. But Harrisville is the town seat.
I'm not from here, so I'm not.
We forgive you.
Okay, thank you. This book is your own experiences, correct?
It is what I call a collective memoir. You know, my mother said, these things happened so many years ago, Annie. How are we going to recall all of this? I said, Mom, do you remember everything that happened to you in that house? She said, yes, everything. I said, well, all the girls are telling me the same thing. And she said, you know, it's amazing. We spent 30 years trying to suppress, to bury our dead. And yet when it came time to exhume them, it is amazing how close to the surface they were buried. When something this surreal happens to you, it's like having your brain branded. It's like being seared into your memory. And even a smell, just an aroma of a specific flower, for instance, can trigger an instant memory and take us back 40 years to the farm. It is something that is a permanent fixture in all of our minds. And I thought, when I put all of this, I interviewed my family ad nauseum. I mean, I have thick notebooks from each member of the family, so that I have not only all their individual experiences of any note or significance, but also the group. And I thought, when I put this manuscript together, nothing's going to match up. How could all these years later, everybody be on the same page with this? And yet when I compiled and I did my cross-referencing and my analysis to make sure that I had it perfectly right, I had to change one season from fall to spring in one story. And other than that, it was exact. These memories are permanent with us.
So that makes me wonder, how faithful were the scenes in the movie?
Well, keep in mind that we inundated the poor producers between Mrs. Warren's case files and what I gave them. They had way more material than they could ever cram into a 2-hour film. So they had to very carefully pick and choose what they were going to use about it, and then weave a story accordingly. There are elements of fiction in it. For instance, Keith Johnson is the one who introduced the Warrens to this story. He told them. He and his group from Rhode Island College had come first, and he said, my mom called him. My mom said, I never called anyone. We don't even know how that happened. It's a discrepancy that's so many decades old, it doesn't matter. I love this man. He's like a brother to me. And he's the one that went to a seminar that they did and said, I understand there's a significant haunting going on. These people are in trouble up in Harrisville. He and his group, Pyro, had come. They were students and came from Rhode Island College. And the first thing that happened was, he came into the house. My mother spoke with him briefly. He asked for a tour. My sisters took him to begin the tour upstairs. And pardon me, but all hell broke loose. He said, I don't see any crucifixes in the house. You know, what do you have for protection? And he asked if we go to church. Well, by that time, the church in Harrisville had rather turned their back on us. We were practicing Catholics. At the time, we moved to the farm, but then we left the church because they suggested perhaps we go worship somewhere else. Unfortunate, but interesting, because that's the foundation of demonology and the belief in spirits is in the Catholic Church. But I think it just freaked our priest out. He just couldn't handle it. And the people in town, we learned quickly not to talk about what was happening at our house. But getting back to that, Keith picked up a piece of sidewalk chalk and he made the sign of the cross on two screens in the upstairs bedroom. The windows came slamming down, the doors slammed shut, everyone was trapped in the bedroom. My sister took a hit upside her head that knocked her to the floor, and everybody bolted out of that room. And he had quite an experience there. That's in volume two.
Now, have you ever figured out who the spirits are?
My mother always said, once we started to accept the fact that we lived in a haunted house, my mother said, they're not just passing through. This isn't coincidence. There's no such thing as coincidence. That's just a word we've made up to explain away the inexplicable. She said, if they're here, they're here with purpose and reason, and they're somehow attached to the house. And then she went on a 2-year research jag that she went everywhere, not only our town hall and Chepachet, Rhode Island, she went all the way to Worcester to get history on the house. And we were pretty much able to determine who the spirits were through old photographs and death notices, birth notices. For instance, the man in the dining room the day we were moving in, my sister Nancy named him Manny because he was a man and she was 9 and thought that was clever. But we actually found out that was Johnny Arnold. And at the age of 54, I believe, he crawled into the eaves in what was my bedroom, drank a bottle of horse liniment, and died an agonizing death. Mrs. Susan Arnold hung herself in the boarding room right off my bedroom. Mrs. John Arnold hung herself in the barn at the age of 93. Bathsheba Sherman, when she died, an old woman in 1885, and the doctor examined her body. He said, I've never seen anything like this. It's in the medical record. It is as if her body has turned to stone. They listed the cause of death as paralysis, but he had to make a personal note because he'd never seen anything like it. Little Prudence Arnold was attacked and raped and murdered in the house. She was only 11 years old, and it happened so fast and so tragically. The poor little thing doesn't know she's dead. Harmony Arnold died in the house. No cause of death listed. She's the one in the kitchen who sweeps the floor. And on and on and on.
They're from, I'm assuming, from the 1800s or
1700s and 1800s, although I have to say the most compelling incident that occurred to me personally was when I was 17, just about to turn 18, I had gone off to college in Pittsburgh at Chatham College, and I missed my family and my farm and my ghosts. I missed everything about this place that I loved so much. No place has ever felt like home to me since the farm. And I begged my father, please fly me home. I want to come home for my birthday, which is October 10th, so it always falls on the Columbus Day weekend, 3 days, yay. And so he did, bless his heart, he flew me home. And I walked in the house and I was so cold, the supernatural cold in the house was beyond description, a cold that is so pervasive that you literally feel it through every cell in your body. But no one else was cold, it was just me. And I said, Mom, she put dinner out on the table, beautiful spaghetti dinner, nice big salad. Oh, this is great, but I have to warm up first. And I backed up to the fireplace. There was a raging fire in October. You know, in October, it gets cold here. And I backed up, and the last thought I had was, I'm wearing my corduroys, and I'm standing too close to the fire. But I couldn't feel the fire. And then all of a sudden, the entire right side of my body turned to a slab of ice. I heard my father drop his fork. He was sitting in the adjacent room at the head of the table. And he said, Annie, someone's come to welcome you home. I turned my head. That's all I could do, because I saw that my father was looking to my right. And of course, that side of my body was frigid. So I knew, and I couldn't move my body. But I could turn my neck, and I looked into my own eyes in the face of an elderly woman who was dressed in 17th century garb with my hair up in a bun, and I knew at that moment that I had lived in that house before, and I didn't tell anyone in my family for 30 years.
Wow. I have one last question for you. You know, you have 10 years worth of experiences. You can't get everything into the books or movie. What is one experience that you really wish you could have gotten into the movie?
There's nothing that I would have added to the film. Nothing. I think it's perfect exactly the way it is. It is James Wan's vision. It is his film, and it is based on the history, not only of our family, but also the career of Ed and Lorraine Warren. I think it is a brilliant and beautiful tribute, not only to their work on behalf of so many souls, earthbound and otherwise, but it is also a really fine telling and a piece of artwork as far as I'm concerned. I've never seen a film like it. I doubt there will ever be a film made like it again. Someday, perhaps, the trilogy of books will find its way to the silver screen, but people tell me all the time when they read the books, they see the movie in there, that I grab them by the necktie or the wrist and just yank them back into the 70s and take them on this incredible spiritual journey with us. So no matter what happens, I'm perfectly satisfied, because you see, either everything happens for a reason or nothing happens for a reason. And I come in on the side of the former. I believe that this was exactly the way it was supposed to be, and I wouldn't change a frame of it.
Perfect.
Were there spirits with you at the premiere?
Yes.
There were. Did they like
yes,
you?
I saw some of the photographs. I had an orb right over my head traveling with me. And you see how I short-circuit things around here.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
It's I so appreciate this invitation today.
Yeah,
it means the world to me.
This is perfect. This is great. I am I